Hey folks, I often get emails about challenges a vendor's facing and trying to get started or has started and is having a rough go at it. And I've done some videos on this. I've answered some emails on it. We've taken calls on the live shows and we've covered about everything you can imagine under the sun in regards to the typical problems vendors face. But sometimes there's little nuances to things, and sometimes you can run into a problem and not realize there can be a solution because you're so mired in the problem that you don't recognize the solutions. Sometimes it's good to have a refresher, something that even if you already have good locations, you may could better them, things like that. But I got an email this week, and it's from a fellow vendor of ours who is just gotten started fairly recently and is having a rough go, and I'm going to read you some of his email. It's a rather large email, but it covers a lot of ground. He's got a great sense of humor even through it all, and I'll try to stop every now and then and answer those things that can help you and him and anyone else that could be helped by it. The email reads, it says, hey Ben, first off, we've had a few conversations on the phone, and thank you for all you do. Well, I got started this January, and my first location was an Ace Hardware here in my town. As I'm sure it is in most town limits, the ordinances can make it difficult to nearly impossible to operate. Here it takes a notarized letter with business owner's or manager's signature, along with a plot picture, so a diagram of the land, marked out where you'll be set up for zoning to review, then approve. If approved, this gives you a 30-day temporary use permit. After that, you may re-up that permit 2 more times each calendar year per spot with a 15 waiting day period between each re-up. So, in short, basically he's saying he's got to find a location, get permission, get a notarized letter saying he has permission to be on the private property, submit that to planning and zoning. Zoning have seen that on a map, have to see where he's going to be located on a map of that property, and then approve that or not. And then he can only be there for 30 days, and then he can't come back to that. He can't re-up that permit. He's got to have a 15-day waiting period. So basically, it's a temporary permit. After that, it says you may re-up, 2 times in a calendar year with a 15 waiting day period between each re-up. Okay. He says, yeah, boring, same old stuff. Probably you hear all the time. Actually, no, that's not stuff I hear a lot. And there's a reason why I don't. He says Ace was a bust. It was January. And after that, I found a car wash in the city limits that is pretty good. And by pretty good, I mean, I was making around $60 on a good day. That's not pretty good. I've had bad days, as most vendors who've worked more than a week have had a bad day or two. It happens. Typically, there's a reason. It can be weather related. It can have nothing to do with you. It could be just that you haven't been there long enough to command a big enough daily flux of customers. But $60 isn't good. It isn't worth to me vending, if that was my take, unless I was going out for an hour, and then it would only be as if somebody else was prepping and cleaning and doing all the other work you have to do for that hour's worth of work that I'm going to be running a cart. It's just not enough, okay? And you can't make a living that way. $60 a day it's a little better than minimum wage at an 8-hour job, but it's still not good. It's not why you would get into this. You won't get into this so you can make minimum wage. We can all do that at McDonald's. We can go to Walmart and make minimum wage. So we don't want to be there. So we're going to cover that more, but I'm going to go back to this first part where he says, I'm sure you run into this a lot. And I said, no, I don't run into this a lot. And there's a reason. That reason being is everything I understand, and I'm not a lawyer, but everything I understand about the laws and every case I have heard about involving restrictive codes where a town says, hey, you cannot vend here except under these horrible tight restrictions. You have to wear a pink bikini. You have to stand on your hands. You can't use your middle fingers to serve. And you have to be blindfolded for half of the day. That's how asinine these types of codes are to me when a city does this. And there's one reason and one reason only, that a city will make a code like this, where they'll make a code that is so restrictive that it almost pushes you out of business. And it is because asshole restaurant owners, business owners, have said, hey, to protect us in the future from vendors, let's create some codes that are so restrictive that we can violate their federal constitutionally guaranteed rights to work. And that's the moral of the story. The bottom line is it violates your constitutional rights to work. You're on private property working your own licensed business, and the city's going to tell you you can only do that for 30 days? Well, most McDonald's, okay, have a store on a corner. They're leasing that property. They're leasing it. Can you imagine a city telling McDonald's, hey, listen, we'd love to have you, but here's the deal. We need a plot map of the property you're leasing, and then for every 30 days, you'll need to re-up that, but you can only re-up it twice a year, and there's got to be at least a 15-day grace period in between each re-up. So we can give you 60 days a year at that location. You're going to love it. McDonald's would have them sued so quick that it'd make their head spin. Bottom line is, vendors can do this. And we have a team of lawyers who will help you do this. If you run into batshit crazy ideas like this that are ridiculous, illegal, unconstitutional, violate your rights as a free American citizen, a taxpayer in America, then by all means, go after them. And go after. Here's how you do it. It won't cost you a dime. It'll take a little time, but it won't cost you a dime. You call the Institute for Justice, send them an email, fill out their web form or whatever. And if you don't know who the heck I'm talking to, you haven't been following me for more than 5 days. And go over to learnhotdogs.com and type in justice as the keyword, and you'll find several articles. I don't mean to sound like a irate, but this kind of stuff pisses me off. Is he's a taxpayer. He's a business owner operating a legal business to operate. He's not opening a crack cart. You know, he's not like serving crack from the cart or got prostitutes hidden inside, or, you know, serving, you know, I don't know, rotten frog legs, that is killing people. He's actually got a licensed business, legal in all 50 states. It's a restaurant of sorts. And they're telling him no, because that's essentially what they've done. They've told him no. I would go to the Institute for Justice. I would, they will tell you, here's what you do first, here's what we'll do second. So what they'll do is they'll encourage you to send they'll help you with this letter that you take to the city, or you can go talk to them in person. I've gone to cities and talked to them in person. Heck, I've called them on phone for other people. But the bottom line is, because sometimes it just gets under my skin, as you can tell, and it just makes my blood boil. And you talk to the city attorney, you talk to the county commissioners, and you go, hey, by the way, this little code right here violates the federal constitutional rights. So what do y'all plan to do about it? Because I want to operate my legal business, and you're infringing on my rights as a citizen. They, in the cases I've seen, they just do a 180. They go, okay, well, we didn't realize that rule would hurt anybody, and they play dumb and they change the rule. Because the bottom line is they have to change the rule. If it comes to a court case, though, Institute for Justice, there's also groups like the ACLU. That's your civil liberties, okay? They've been known to step in these cases. There's lawyers that step in, but ACLU and the Institute for Justice, and like in North Carolina, my neighboring state, they have a group called Constitutional Attorneys that do pro bono work. That's what they do. They just do free work for people that have their rights violated, specifically businesses. So there you have it. That's what I would do there, and that would eliminate this problem. It isn't going to be overnight, but, and so I don't tell you to, okay, well, you're just going to hang your hat up for 6 months while you get this ironed out. Sometimes this can be ironed out immediately. Jason Brown, my good friend and fellow vendor, had a similar situation and got the letter to the right people in a town that neighbored him, and they immediately changed the law. They changed that code because they were in violation of his civil rights. The Constitution guarantees you the Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights guarantee you the right to work. So, I'm sorry I went on that little rant and tangent. And if you search rant, you'll see that isn't the first time I've caved to my caveman mentalities. He goes further to say, as I had mentioned on the phone, and I would never expect you to remember our conversations, but I do, I had been to place after place asking and asking. I soon found the problem wasn't the people didn't necessarily want me, they just weren't authorized to give me permission. What he's talking about is you go into Tractor Supply and they go, well, we can't give you permission to do that, that's a corporate decision. Well, there's ways around that, and I teach that in my free training, but there's also, corporate isn't big, bad, and scary. You don't have to be scared to go to them. It's usually a pain, and it's usually harder. It requires more time, but it's not the end of the world to go through corporate to get permission. But, worded correctly, typically you can go to these places and get immediate access. I cover this, and I'm going to tell you real briefly. A lot of vendors make the mistake of going to a business, and they go, I have a hot dog cart. We'd love to set up here in front of your business. Can we do that? And it's kind of like you're asking, which you are, but there's a better way to do that. Instead of acting like you want to be a permanent fixture in their parking lot, say, listen, we have a hot dog business, and we do catering and all kinds of stuff. And next Tuesday, we're going to be in your area and wanted to see if you'd like us to set up in the parking lot. It'll probably draw some customers in. We'll serve your customers. Our prices are reasonable. We won't charge you a dime. You're asking for permission without letting them know. It's reverse psychology, basically. It's a reverse sale. And though it'll look like it will appear as you're doing them a favor. And in actuality, you are. You're not lying. You're not cheating. You're not deceiving them. You're changing the wording, okay? You're changing the way you're asking. And by saying, hey, would you like us to come serve your customers and everything? That'll probably bring some more customers into you. Heck, we'll even give your employees a free meal that day. That's goodwill, and it shows, it looks like you're doing them a favor, and they'll go, oh, yeah, heck, yeah, come on down. There's another little thing, and if you need to look this up on Learn Hot Dog's blog, the charity thing. Look up the charity thing because that can work in your benefit, the using a charity. So if you have a small charity in your town that you can benefit, you want to help them. And I never use the big national charities. I'll use the local Humane Society, the local women's shelter, the local food pantry. And I'll go, hey, we fundraise for the food pantry. And we're going to be in your neighborhood next Tuesday and wanted to see if you would like us to come by and won't cost you a dime. You see how I did that? Won't cost you a dime. And we'll serve your customers. It'll probably bring more people in and we'll raise some money for the food bank. And they'll go, absolutely. Well, you didn't tell a lie. Give a portion of your proceeds to the food bank. I do anyway. Many vendors do. Michael Woods gives every day to his local town Wounded Warrior Project. It's called something else, but it's the Wounded Warrior Project. You can do that. And there's nothing wrong with that. I didn't say I was the Wounded Warrior Project. I said I was a hot dog and catering company. And I'm bringing this to you. These are ways to word this so that you break the ice. It doesn't look like you're begging them for a spot. It also doesn't look permanent. Now, here's the neat part. Once you're there and you've done a good day and you fed them and you've had a good day and you decide you want to be there again, more than likely they're going to ask you to come back. But if they don't, you can go inside and go, hey, we appreciate it. Next time we're in the area, we'll call and see if you want to do this again sometime. A lot of them at that point will go, hey, could you come back like once a week? Or you may want to just be upfront. I've done this and go, hey, we had a good day today. Did y'all enjoy that? I think the customers loved it. We had some people eating 17 hot dogs, you know, blah, 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 small talk. And then you go, how would you like it if we come back another day real soon? Well, sure. Well, that could be tomorrow. It could be the next day. And once you figure out what days to be there that are your busiest days, now you've got a permanent spot. So every Tuesday and Thursday, you're going to be at the such and such. That's how you get to a position without being told, like he's saying, he's asking the wrong people that that he needs to go through corporate. They are unauthorized. That's how you get around that. In most cases. He goes on to say, so I started brainstorming and looking at our city limit map and found that here where I am, the city limit looks like a blood splatter analysis of an unsolved murder mystery from 1982. I about fell out of my chair when I heard that because, you know, everything's serious till you get to that point. And then he throws in that little bit of sarcasm and wit, and I love it. I love sarcasm, if you haven't noticed. And he says, which is to say, if you cross the street in a lot of places, you will unknowingly be out of the city limits and in a hollow covered land of county property, which is where you can set up a nuclear missile silo as long as you inform the county by writing it down on a bar napkin and leaving it taped to the office door. So basically, the county is a lot more lenient, is what he's saying. For those trying to set up missile silos, nuclear missile silos, that was just sarcasm there and wit. And so I hope you caught that. So here I am, he says, searching and finding county property to set up at. Well, I found an alignment shop. The guy loves me. He wants me. He was practically begging me to set up. The problem was it's a parking lot not much bigger than my queen size mattress, not attached to anything and not anywhere near where folks would usually be walking. I would be depending on his customers alone, and this made me nervous. Anyway, at one point I said, F it and set it up. It is a very high visibility spot. I actually did okay there because of surrounding employees and delivery drivers coming in and out. I recently went back and the same thing seemed to do okay. I was actually getting customers from the road, and each time I wanted to touch their faces to make sure they were real and that I didn't actually die 10 minutes prior and wasn't in some kind of weird hot dog afterlife. So at this point in my weenie slinging life, he says, I am at a place where I will just about offer to trade people physical labor if they will buy a hot dog from me. And I love that. I love this sense of humor here. Here's his mental dilemma. He says, I have a good product. I serve a well-made, steamed, delicious hot dog at a great price and offer a multitude of toppings that are included in my $2 price tag that people actually compliment me on and enjoy. The only thing I charge extra for is the 50 cent for chili. I do a meal deal as well, the old $5 meal deal from my book. Yes, I could do more with signage, he says, but I haven't mustered up the courage to spend what few straw pennies I have on them. I advertise in my local, you know, my location and whatnots on Facebook. Facebook is great. Okay. It's not the key to your success though. Signage is more key. And even if you have to go buy a 75 cent dollar store, poster board for a kid's project and take big magic markers or small magic markers and make big letters, you're going to come out ahead than to not have signage. How many people are you missing daily? Because what is the difference between a $60 day and a $300 day? It's about 245 into 240. It's about 40 customers, roughly. Are 40 people passing by that don't know you exist? And that would be what I would do. I would have to come up with a way for signage. Even if I had to use milk jugs filled with water and then written on, that said hot H on one and O on another and spelled out hot dog and set them out by the road and made it look cute. You know, maybe paint the caps or tie an umbrella, a balloon to each one. I would do something as inexpensive as I could to make that work because these are investments that do pay off. They're not investments that you go, boy, I hope that works. It made me feel better to have my license plate say hot dog on it. That's the kind of shit that doesn't really make you any money. But doing filling jugs up with water and writing, spelling out hot dog and putting them near an entrance and then taking those up at the end of the day, those types of things will make you money. You could color, you could spray paint and make spray paint the milk jugs red, make them stand out with white letters, you know, tape the letters out first and then spray them red and it will stand out. It'd be something weird when somebody's driving by and go, what the hell? Oh, hot dogs, and pull in. So I would be marketing. You have to market. Marketing is not an expense. It's not an expense. It is an investment, and sometimes it's a short investment. I mean, it pays off instantly. I can do things one day and have it pay off the same day or 30 minutes later. So you want to market. If you want other marketing ideas, same thing, learnhotdogs.com. I have learned a ton of marketing tricks from fellow vendors, like Corey Lawrence and Michael Wood and Jason Brown and, the ones that have been on the radio show for the last, you know, few years. Those I've learned a lot, and we've all learned from other vendors. So we all share this vast knowledge. It's not like, oh, Ben's got all the knowledge and he's really freaking smart. Well, no, I just learned it from other people. And so that's how this stuff works. Let's see. He goes on to say, he says, I'm a mafia member. I've watched the videos. I've studied what I can. I am also in an area that only has a handful of food vendors. So I have almost zero, you know, competition. Right down the road is, he says, Charleston, where it's a bit more common but doesn't really affect him. Which brings me to say this, what the hell is going on, man? It would appear I'm in the perfect situation to dominate the market and make a killing. I'm clearly missing something and doing something wrong. I just can't figure it out. So on my electronic email knees, I ask you, is there something in anything I said that makes you think, oh, yeah, you're not doing this, idiot, or whatever? And he goes, whatever you say, I'm not worried about your critique. He says, spare no harshness in my 6 years in the military. He said, Uncle Sam ripped his soul out and ate it for dinner. So don't worry about his feelings. Basically, he's military, so he can take the abuse. He says, give it to me straight. I don't have any abuse. The little bit I told you in the beginning where I touched on those things, those would be the most impactful to me. But we do need to cover some, what do you go from here though? I haven't given you any clear cut choices other than something you do need to do is have freaking signs, new locations in the county while you fight the battle with the city, or you get that battle started for an Institute for Justice. So you do have some good news. You've got a whole bunch of good news today and you're going to resolve this, I promise. And you'll probably get that ruling overturned in the city. Then it'll be the first one that didn't get overturned if I hear you didn't. And then if you will work on the places you know you can get in quickly and easily without the ridiculous 30-day bullshit thing, then go with the county spots. Find those spots that are the best and get them, because they're... there's going to be some good spots, and they may be things that you don't even think that may be good. Who would have thought, okay? Who would have thought that a pull of parts would work? Who would have thought a factory gig in the middle of the night between 11 p.m. and 1 a.m. for me would make me 900 plus a week, 2 days a week? Who would have thought that? Not many people. So there's somewhere you can be. There's somewhere there in your county in those little, you know, those patches that you don't have to follow that ridiculous crap the city's done is and get a location. I've also shared with you how to approach those locations now. Reapproach them. Change it up a little bit. Get on Craigslist and talk about catering. If you don't know anything about catering, go to our last show we just did. Go before those shows. We've been talking about catering for 2.5 years. I've been jamming it down vendors' throats going, please take this and run with it, because it is making money. It is taking vendors from $40,000 a year to $140,000 a year. It's taking vendors from a regular business. Okay. They may be making $100,000 a year, maybe making $80,000 a year. And it's going boom. They're making the same money now, but working way less because they're working 2 days a week doing catering instead of 5 days a week on a cart. So all these things make a difference. So check out the catering and start putting fillers out for that and make yourself available and do it for free. Do it on Facebook, do it on Craigslist. Once you go back and you hit up some of these new spots, you've got a new lease on life. Basically, you starting over from scratch. You've got a location or two now, but now think about going back to some of the ones you talked to before, going to some of the ones outside of that city limit issue, talking to them and offering your services. You may find one or two spots that all you need is those one or two, that where you just need to work one day here and one day here and you're done for the week. There's vendors doing this. If you don't believe me, ask on Facebook. There's vendors doing this. Hundreds of vendors are working 2 and 3 days a week, making a really good living. Some vendors are working their butts off and making, you know, big money, you know, a couple hundred thousand, 300,000. Those are few and farther between because they require just tons of extra work. But it's all doable. There's nothing between you and them. There's nothing different. They're not luckier. There's no difference in this situation with your email. There's no difference between you changing all this up overnight. Poster boards, milk jugs, whatever you can come up with to make a cool looking sign, crazy it up, even if it's cheap, even if you have to tear off your neighbors who just got a new refrigerator and tear up their cardboard and cut it out and make signs and spray paint it so that it at least looks like you spent some time on the sign, and don't just like graffiti it. Don't make it look trashy, but just make it stand out like weird. Okay. Milk jugs are weird. Coke cans, you know, you could hang Coke cans off the top of cardboard and it looks weird. Paint them orange, you know, and all of a sudden you got something weird, wacky going on, and it catches people's eyes. And then they see this nice clean cart and a nice dressed person, you know, that's got a clean environment serving, and you're going to be busier and you're going to get extra people. 10 extra people, that's $50 extra a day. Well, now you talk, okay, I worked the lunch shift. That's 2 to 3 hours of work. Now you're talking $100, $150. That's good money now. Make that every day. That's 2 part-time jobs, basically, crammed into 3 hours. You know, 16 hours worth of part-time money into 3 hours. So not a bad living. But search for more. Don't be happy there. Don't at all be happy there, because we know vendors, and I've been one, and there's lots of others out there live right now who are making $400 and $500 a day, and they don't have to work 7 days a week. They're working this spot here, or this spot on this day and this day, or 3 days a week, you know? So crap, most of us would be tickle pink. We've come from either not making money, broke as convicts or whatever, and we don't have money. And so to get $200 a day for 5-6 hours of work, including your cleanup and tear down and prep and everything, 5-6 hours, that's good money. I mean, that's $40 an hour job. So don't be dissatisfied if you have a $200 day because somebody else made $600, because it doesn't freaking matter. You can have $600 days. It's all up to you. It's all up to you if how much effort you put into finding locations and getting those spots. I know you'll do this. I know your sense of humor, the fact that you've been in the military, it shows the type of person you are. You have the mentality and the integrity to rock on. And so you're not really doing anything wrong. And hopefully I've inspired you with some ideas that will encourage you to go out, because you can resolve this. You can solve this on all the fronts and make tons more money. And all of a sudden this will become, dang, what am I going to do Thursday? It's raining and I'm closed and I was going to go fishing. So our blog, write them in there, go to our Facebook page. I thank you. I love you. I hope you have a good evening. Thank you.